those of us who are parents with children, well, obviously, with children, or work with children, you'd be aware of the well-known fact that they very rarely do something the first time you ask them to do it. Amen. In fact, they very rarely do it the third, fourth, or fifth time you ask them to do it sometimes, judging by my experience. In fact, I'm still saying things that I'm sure I was saying about 2 or 3 years ago. We can relate to that, can't we? As parents, or if you work with children, you know that you have to be persistent in your instruction. And it's not necessarily because they're downright disobedient. Sometimes that is the case. It has to be said, that is what's at the root. But sometimes it's because they just forget. Or maybe it's a little bit outside of their experience. And they don't quite understand why it is they can't do that. Or they don't understand why it is you're saying you must do this. I don't know, a simple example of, you know, washing your hands after you've been to the toilet. Well, why? Well, there's germs on your hands. Where? I can't see them. I actually heard a conversation between children. That's that, you know, where are the germs? Well, they're very small. Why are they small? Well, God made them that way, was the answer. So we do have to be repetitious, to say the least, when you're trying to get something to register with your child or children. Guess what? It's the same with us and God. Exactly the same. Not necessarily because we're disobedient, but we forget. Or maybe it just doesn't fit in to our view of where we're at. Or where we think God's taking us to. It doesn't fit. This isn't what I expected. I don't understand. I'll leave it to one side. Well, God's gracious, isn't he? And he repeats himself, doesn't he? And what I want to say is that scripturally, when God repeats himself, he wants us to take him seriously. When he repeats himself in scripture, it's like an underlining. You need to pay attention to this. Now, quite a while ago, at an Envisioned meeting, Envisioned is a group of people within the church who move in the prophetic. And we meet every now and then, and we do different things in different meetings. And this one meeting, I had brought a selection of articles from home, just regular, or maybe a little bit different, household objects. And we used them to see what God was saying to the church, use them as objects to focus our thinking and our praying. And God spoke to us out of them. And when I was thinking about this particular meeting, when I was asked to lead this meeting, and David's very clever, he asks people to do things way in advance. And it's kind of like, oh, yeah, April, yeah, I'll do that. And oh, why did I say yes? So this is a while back, and I was reminded of this meeting we had in Envisioned. And the cloth you can see there is one of the things that we had. And a few of us were reminded through this cloth of the statement in scripture where we are called a royal priesthood. And I thought, yes, I think we want to talk about this. Because a number of people in that Envisioned meeting said, this is a good thing. This is something that the church could do well to hear, to remind them of who they are in God. And I'm not a biblical scholar. So when I came to try and find that piece of scripture, and I found it eventually, there it is. It's in 1 Peter, isn't it? And I think, oh, that's funny. David's preaching on 1 Peter. Well, this is kind of chapter 2-ish, and I know he's been preaching for a little while on this series, so I wonder what he said when he did that bit. And because I'm not here every week, maybe I'm in Sunday club, or maybe I'm away like I was away last week, and I just mentioned in passing to him this week gone, this is what I was preaching on, and he said, that's why I preached on last Sunday. Who was here last Sunday? God's talking to you. Rest of you can go. No. Who did their homework? Do you remember David asked you about setting your reminders on your mobile phones to remind you during the week that it's still the same God that we're worshipping and we should still be in that attitude of worship? He asked me to check up. I'll take names later. Joking aside, I believe that God is wanting to underline something here in Scripture to us. It's not just some vague thing out there. This is for Greenford Baptist Church, and if you're sitting here this morning, or if you're listening to this recording, it's for you, Greenford Baptist Church. As I say, when God repeats something, it's serious stuff. It's just one verse, verse 9. So we're looking at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. So Peter has been talking about the fact that we are living stones where God's presence is dwelling and we are being built together. He talks about the stone that was rejected, and he talks about the fact that people who don't understand that stumble on that stone representing Jesus, because they disobey the message. And in verse 9 he says, but you, that's us, you are chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking this morning, because I think it's more important that we create some space for response to what God said last week and what he's saying now. So I'm going to talk for a short while. It's important to understand what the role of the priest was in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the priests were taken from the tribe of Levi, and they were set apart to serve God and to serve Israel. So in Exodus, it's just one verse, but it just... Exodus chapter 28, God says to Moses, call your brother Aaron and his sons, set them apart from the rest of the people of Israel, so they may minister to me and be my priests. And as David said last week, that role of ministering was one completely given over to that tribe. They were the only ones that could go into the temple. They were the only ones that could go into the presence of God, because that's where God's presence was in the Old Testament. They were the only ones. And the high priest was the only one that could go into the Holy of Holies. And that was only once a year. This was a privileged position. We need to understand that. Just imagine for a moment that David was the only one who could go into God's presence on our behalf. You can't do that. I can't even begin to imagine what that must be like. Not to have that contact. But now, we can. In Hebrews chapter 10, it explains how that's all been changed. In the previous chapter, it talks about the old way of worship, this whole thing about how the tabernacle was set up, and that the priest could only go in once a year into the Holy of Holies. But the writer of Hebrews says that has now changed. We can go into that place. You and me, we can go into that place. Chapter 10, verse 19. So, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean, and our bodies have been washed with pure water. We can do it. We can go into the presence of God. We don't have to have done anything at all. We are qualified. And how are we qualified? We're qualified because God allowed Jesus to die in our place. We can go into that holy place. And it's because of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross that that's possible for us. So now we're the priests. We can go in. We can enter his presence. That's what I think he wants us to understand. He wants to engage with us at a more intimate level. He doesn't want us to stand on the edge. He wants us to come into his presence, and to understand that that is fine. That's okay. Whatever your condition, that's fine. That doesn't matter to God, because Jesus has made it possible. And alongside that, it comes with a responsibility. Just as the priests in the Old Testament stood in the gap between God and the people of Israel, we now stand in the gap between God and the people around us. That's a massive responsibility. We have to see that. And we don't see that and experience it if we don't go into his presence and recognize that we can do it. We're a holy nation. To be holy means to be set apart, like the priests in the Old Testament. We're not with the world. We're in it, but we're not with it. We're separate from it. We're called to be holy. A little while before, in the first chapter of 1 Peter, Peter quotes something from Leviticus that says, "Be holy as I am holy." It's a command. It's not a suggestion. It's not a wonder if you might. It's a command. And in Leviticus, it's said at least three times. At least three times. And what I found interesting was the third one that I found in Leviticus 20, verse 7, God says again, "So set yourselves apart to be holy, for I am the Lord your God. Keep all my decrees by putting them into practice, for I am the Lord who makes you holy." He does it on our behalf. And for us, the agent of holiness is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwelling within us is how that holiness comes about. Someone I read this week said that command, "Be holy as I am holy," is a command, a summons to obedience, to conform to God's standards. That's really difficult, really difficult. Because there's so many subtle things in life where we fall down. But But that's okay, because we've got the Holy Spirit within us. We can come before Jesus. We know we have the promise that he can give us forgiveness and cleanse us from the stuff where we fall down, and we can be restored. In Romans 8, it says this about the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, verse 5. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. It's the Holy Spirit within us. The other thing that we are is chosen, hand-picked, and owned by God. And the Holy Spirit plays a part in that too, because the Holy Spirit seals our identity. It's his mark of ownership on us. You've got the Holy Spirit, you belong to God. You are his. He possesses you. Further on in Romans 8, verse 14, Paul says this: For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. You have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father, for his Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. I'll read you a quote here from F.F. Bruce, who says this about what I've just read to you. The term adoption may have a somewhat artificial sound in our ears, but in the Roman world, to whom this letter was written, an adopted son was a son deliberately chosen by his adoptive father to perpetuate his name and inherit his estate. He was no way inferior in status to a son born in the ordinary course of nature and might well enjoy the father's affection more fully and reproduce the father's character more worthily. How about that then? I didn't know that. Deliberately chosen by God. Chapter 1 of Ephesians, verse 4 and 5 says this: Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. Do you recognize yourself? Do you? Because it's true. However you feel this morning with regard to being called a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation — I'm not holy. I've had a terrible week. I've done this, I've thought that, I did that, I didn't do this. We could all — I'm not going to ask you — we could all go around and say, I'm disqualified because of this, 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 and this. But I can come back to you with all the stuff I've just read from the Bible and say to you, bah, but you are qualified because of Jesus. Whether you like it or not, it's there for the taking. Now, when we make appeals at church for people to come forward for prayer, it's good. It's good, it's right. And a lot of the time, it's people have got concerns, worries, problems, things they can't see a way through. And that's good and right. And long may it last. Not the problems, they're coming for prayer. But what I would like to suggest is that God would like to bless us, regardless of our condition. Now, as I've been going through these descriptions this morning and telling you that we are adopted sons and daughters of the living God, that we are a royal priesthood, we have nothing to stop us going boldly into his presence. For the Star Trek fans among us, boldly go. If you don't remember anything, just remember that this morning. It's there. If you don't recognise yourself in that, then God wants to do business with you this morning. However, if you do recognise yourself in that, God wants to do business with you this morning. Because he never stops blessing. He never stops giving, and he wants to give. Why? Because he's our loving Heavenly Father. And don't you dare sit there and think, no, not me. Because this is for you this morning. This is why he said it last week. This is why I'm here standing here this week saying exactly the same thing. He wants you to know this. And more than that, to allow him to show you it and experience it and take it. Parents again. Yes, we have to repeat ourselves for our children's obedience or compliance. But how good is it to give gifts to your children? Yes, birthdays, yes, Christmas. But you see something in a shop, a book, a toy or something, and you see it and you think, oh, I would love to give that. For no other reason other than you want to give them a gift. Yes? Not because they've been ill and you want them to cheer up. We do that. Not because they've been particularly good at school. For no other reason other than you are in love with them and you want to express that to them. And of course it's not going to happen, but what if you went up to, I went up to Sophie and I said, it's my daughter, I said, here we are, look, I bought you this book. Whatever it is. You know, a program on the TV that she really loves. I know, it's her favourite. And she looks at it and says, well, maybe later. Puts it down and doesn't go back to it. That's what we do when we sit or stand or listen to these words and disqualify ourselves. Okay. I really do believe this is what God wants to do for us today. To express his love, to dwell amongst us. As I was looking through scripture, I came across a couple of things that really, really struck me. Almost as if he was saying it directly into Greenford this morning. We're about to go into our mission, my father's business. How are we going to stand in the gap, be Jesus to these people, if we won't even step into his presence and allow him to bless us? How are we going to do it? Well, we're not. We are the priests. We are the ones that are going to stand in the gap. Be that connection, be that bridge, that link. But first, we need to allow ourselves to go into his presence and allow him to minister to us. I read this in Ephesians chapter 1, 18 and 19. Take this as a prayer. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honour. I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope that he has given to those he called. His holy people, who are his rich and glorious inheritance. I'll read that again. I pray that your heart will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called, his holy people, who are his rich and glorious inheritance. That's what I pray this morning. that his light is going to shine in your hearts, that you're going to understand. Where God's presence is, there his glory is also. And God is jealous for his church. Jealous for his church. He wants to dwell in his church and for his glory to be seen in his church. That's us. That's us. We need to accept that and allow that to happen. Turning back to 1 Peter chapter 2, I've got a slightly different version. I've got the New Living Translation. And that verse 9, after he says, chosen people, royal priesthood, holy nation, God's very own possession, as a result, you can show others the goodness of God. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. Do we want to be able to do that? Do we? Well, he certainly does. What I'm going to do in a moment is we're going to have a bit of moving around. And I'm going to create a space here with the help of others. With this cloth. Now, this cloth is cloth. Very, very attractive. It's just a piece of cloth. I don't think there's anything special about this piece of cloth. I want to say that categorically. However, I think it's a very strong image of what God is saying we are, of what we are in Christ. Whether we recognise it or not, that's who we are. And I want us to see this as a representation of that this morning. So there's going to be a chance in a short while to respond. I'm going to stop talking in a minute, and we'll do something up here so that people can respond. I just want to share one last piece of scripture with you. Turning back to Romans. That piece I read to you from Ephesians about praying that the light will shine in your heart to give you understanding. I really felt that was my prayer for the church this morning. Also, this. Chapter 8 of Romans, chapter 8, verse 29 and 30. Here we go again. That's me, not me. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them right standing with him. And having given them right standing, he gave them his glory. I have believed for a long time that God wants to give more of himself to us, if only we'd let him. In one sense, we're always in his presence. Always, always, always in his presence. We have the Holy Spirit. It's his dwelling place. But I believe there is a deeper experience of him that he's wanting to bless us with. Drawing us into the Holy of Holies. Deeper into him. He's so jealous for our own company. He chose us. He chose us. He wants to dwell with his people. He wants his presence to be known. Why would he say this if it were not so? Let his glory be seen in his church. Then we can stand in the gap. In my mind's eye, this vision of this blessing that God's wanting to pour out. It was like, you know, in a party sometimes when they have this big container holding balloons that go and the balloons come down from the ceiling. So I'm going to need 4 volunteers to help me with this. If you don't mind standing on chairs. This is just a piece of cloth, but I want you to come and I want you to just pass under the canopy. If you need to kneel or stand beneath it for a while, that's fine. Whatever you feel God's asking you to do. You might want to pass under it. There's a space over there. Stand, kneel, lay. Whatever's appropriate for you in your response to God this morning, whatever it is, it doesn't matter as long as you come and receive this blessing that God is wanting to give us. Take all the time you want, but come to God. Can I encourage you that to move, and if you will remain in an attitude of prayer, that's great, that's right and good, but to move through so that it gives everybody a chance to get through this. Yeah, you don't have to remain in your seats. You can come and remain in an attitude of prayer in the space over here.
I was watching the changing over of people, just a tap to get their attention and then taking over from them. And we are to do this for each other. This is us holding the glory. Holding the glory. And being there to spread the glory to each other. Not anyone in particular, but all of us as the royal priesthood. To be holding the glory, to be bringing the glory to each other. I don't know how many people stood up there, but there were others who thought, I'd better go in a minute, somebody's getting tired. And there wasn't time for you, but the intention was there. And that intention to bring down God's glory for each other, and to be blessing to each other, and to be God's presence to each other, to be this holy priesthood.
Father, thank you for what you've allowed us to do here this morning. Father, I pray that as you've seen these willing hearts, you would bless us. Lord, I just want to simply say, your will be done. Your glory come, and your will be done in your people here, your royal priesthood. In Jesus' name.